I welcome all of you with my love and blessings. Today's subject is peace. Few basic truths about the peace. Please understand, the entire universe is a projection of who you are. You see and respond to things the way you are, not the way the things are. First, you need to understand few basic things about you. The entire universe is projection of you. You can see in your life, suddenly, when your interest turns towards spirituality, you will feel a lot of spiritual informations are coming to you. You are attracting that kind of friends. You are having that kind of experiences, ideas. You feel suddenly whole world is becoming spiritual. Many people come and tell me, Swamiji, last few years, world is becoming more spiritual, is it not? I tell them, no, you are becoming more spiritual. Because you see that kind of friends, because you are getting more that kind of information, books, websites, programs, lifestyle, you feel whole world is becoming spiritual. The basic truth you need to know, the entire universe is your projection. You can create peace outside only if you can create peace within. World is a mirror and stands as a reflection of your inner space every moment. Whole universe is a mirror and it reflects your inner space every moment. We always tend to think how to bring peace to the world. How do I work towards global peace? But you forget an important point. You are the foundation of your world. Without attending to the foundation, you try to attend to everything else. Bring peace to you first. Only then you will have the most practical, useful methods of bringing global peace. Otherwise, all the work you try to do to bring peace to others only will be projection of your ego onto them, your arrogance towards them. It will be only your torture to them. Please understand, without bringing peace to you, which is foundation of your world, you try to bring peace to everything. Being peaceful within means being in completely unclutched space of the restful awareness, space internally, and taking more and more responsibility and being productive externally. Please understand. Let me define peace. Understand, I am defining peace. Peace means being at ease internally and responding to the world in a most efficient way and being most productive to the humanity. If you wish to authentically make a difference and bring peace to the world, you must first bring peace yourself within. Being peaceful within means being in completely unclutched space. or the restful awareness space. Restful awareness space internally, and taking more and more responsibility and being productive externally. Responding to yourself and to the world most efficiently is peace. Let me define this word unclutching. Being unclutched. When you are not transferring the stress and load created by one thought to the other thought and carrying that load constantly. Please understand, usually you transfer the load and the stress you create by one thought to the other thought, and when you are constantly transferring those emotions to the next thought, next thought, next thought, your inner space becomes insensitive, loaded with so much of emotions, it naturally sinks into depression, restlessness, boredom, all the negative emotions. When you can unclutch, unclutching is not connecting one thought and the other thought and carrying the same stress and emotions. When you unclutch, you stop carrying the stress and negative emotions from one thought to the other thought. And when you don't carry that stress, suffering, negativity, pressure, restlessness from one thought to the other thought, naturally you experience peace inside. There are different levels of peace. Peace at the level of self, being in the restful awareness zone at all times, being unclutched within, is peace at the level of self. Please understand, every human being has a birthright for the peace within. The peace at the level of self is a birthright of every human being, and everyone should do it. Everyone should have this peace to experience life while you are living. Please understand, experience peace while you are living. Don't wait for death to come to show peace to you. When people pray for the dead people, may his soul rest in peace, sometimes I feel like laughing. Why do you wait for death to come and teach you how to be in peace? But I also wanted you to know one thing. If you don't taste peace while you are alive, be rest assured, you are never going to have rest or assurance in your life. Even after death, if you are not peaceful while you are living, you are not going to be peaceful when you die. First, peace at the level of self. It's a birthright and your birth responsibility. We talk so much about birthrights, but we never talk about our birth responsibilities. I tell you, having peace at the level of self is your responsibility. Not only your right, your responsibility. Second, peace at the level of family. Being unclutched and matured in your relationships and executing your responsibility towards your family and relationships. Understand, peace at the level of family, I am defining. Being unclutched in your relationships and executing your responsibility towards your family and relationships. Every householder, person who has a family, is responsible for his family's peace. Even if you are not the head of the family, please understand, it is not that always only head of the family is responsible for the peace of the family. No. Every person who is part of the family is responsible for the peace of the family. Third, peace at the level of community. Being unclutched in the way you relate with your community, taking up the responsibility towards your community and performing actions that radiate responsibility. Understand, I am defining peace at the level of community. Being unclutched in the way you relate, with your community, taking up responsibility towards your community and performing actions that radiate responsibility. I tell you, when you unclutch, so much of your inner space will be freely available to you. You will have so much of inner space freely available to you. You will be able to do so many creative things, radiating responsibility. Peace at the level of society, being unclutched in the way you relate to the society and being responsible at the societal level. Please understand, at this moment, at this level, peace at the level of society, only at this level you really feel the sacrifice, the tyaga, the joy of sacrifice starts happening to you. I am so happy. People from all over USA, as on now, at this moment, have gathered in front of White House in Washington. All our followers and devotees have gathered in front of White House to radiate peace in Washington, D.C., taking social responsibility. All of them have gathered to spread the vibrations of the peace, to radiate the Kundalini energy, bring global peace. Because if you can bring peace into the Washington, D.C. and all the people in the Washington, D.C., if you can bring peace in their mindsets, you will bring peace to the whole world. They are in Washington Oval by the White House. It is pouring down with rain and cold. A lot of people are walking by. Our devotees are sitting, meditating, handing out flyers to people, and I am receiving a request from them to stop the rain. It will stop within next 10 minutes. I tell you, rain will stop within next 10 minutes. You guys will be able to attend the webinar peacefully. You will be able to attend the watch. You will be able to watch the webinar. Blessings. Nature will cooperate with you guys. Blessings. When you try to bring peace at the level of society, you experience the joy of sacrifice. I tell you, only at that moment you really feel, what can I contribute to others and make a difference? If you are bringing peace at the level of self, family, community, all these three is selfishness, because you are living there, you need to have it. But when you work to bring the peace at the level of human society, whole humanity, you will experience the joy of sacrifice, because you need to sacrifice a lot to bring the peace to the world. Sometimes even your own peace. But only when you bring the peace, please understand, there's a big difference between people who never had peace in the self but try to bring global peace. No, that is wrong way. But ready to sacrifice your own individual peace for global peace means you have peace at the level of self, but you are ready to sacrifice for the peace of human society. That is the attitude of Bodhisattva. In Buddhism, we have a tradition of Bodhisattvas who achieved the ultimate enlightenment, but who are ready to sacrifice, forego their own nirvana, enlightenment, to share with others, contribute to others' life and make a difference. In Hindu tradition, we call them as incarnations. Incarnations are those who achieved, ready to sacrifice even the enlightenment for the sake of making difference in others' life by contributing. When each individual is established in being unclutched at the level of self, naturally he will create the peace at the level of family, then at the level of community, and it will expand to the level of society. Naturally, peace has to start happening at the level of nation and the whole civilization itself. I can give you some examples from Vedic civilization for this. Vedic civilization was one such civilization for many, many centuries. Please understand, I am not giving you some dreams, ideas about golden past. There was a time, the past was very sweet, great, everything was good, milk and honey was flowing like a river. No, I am not giving you all those stories. I am giving you the honest truth. Vedic civilization really made world peace as reality. It was peaceful, prosperous, and leading the world in all aspects, never ruling the world in all aspects, but leading the world in all aspects, economically, socially, intellectually, and above all, spiritually, consciously. Please understand, Vedic civilization was leading the world, never ruling the world. The civilizations which wanted to rule the world brought destruction to the world. Please understand, if you have confidence in what you stand by, what you experience, what is the truth, you will just lead by your example. You will never feel like ruling it. Vedic civilization never tried to politically rule the world, but it was always leading the world. The ideas they were living was so perfect. Just by living, everybody was automatically following them, inspired by them. By inspiring, Vedic civilization was leading the world. Whether their dimensions of generation and celebration of wealth or concepts and truths about life, in every way they were leading the world. Vedic civilization was the only civilization at one point in time in the history of the world civilizations which was the richest in the world. Vedic civilization was a land of richness and abundance in natural resources, material wealth like diamonds, gold and other precious stones and metals, everything. The intellectual wealth of the Vedic civilization, the greatest surgeons first surgeon recorded in the human history is Indian surgeon Sushruta. He is the author of the book Sushruta Samhita, which describes 300 surgical procedures, 120 surgical instruments, classifies human surgery in 8 categories. He lived, taught and practiced his art on the banks of Ganges in the area that corresponds to present day city of Varanasi around 800 BC in North India. Because of his seminal and numerous contributions to the science and art of surgery, he is also known by the name Father of Surgery. Please understand, Vedic civilization produced greatest mathematicians like Aryabhatta. He was the first Indian mathematician. Please understand, first mathematician who is from Vedic civilization. An astronomer from the classical age of Indian mathematics and Indian astronomy. He was the great mathematician who invented the number zero and gifted it to the world. He also worked on the mathematical symbols, pi, and also invented trigonometry. He discovered and defined the area of triangle. His contributions are the backbone to the entire science of mathematics and astronomy that followed, that whole world followed. The place value system and zero, the place value system first seen in the 3rd century Bakshali manuscript was the invention of Aryabhatta. Please understand, when you bring peace at the individual level, at the level of self, your inner space will be able to invent, create, manifest many of the great things of nature. Apart from this, Vedic civilization was the number one civilization in the world leading in arts, painting, music, pottery and all other forms of arts depicting a rich culture. I tell you, even now, if you travel in India, every 100 kilometer you will have a different kind of food, different kind of dressing, different kind of dancing. When I say dance, not just movements of the body, even the instruments, music instruments they use, and the material they use for the music instruments, everything will be unique. The dress people, the dress people wear in Mysore, and the dress people wear in Hosur will be completely different. Not only the way they stitch or the way they wear, the fabric or the source material for the fabric will be different. Every 100 kilometer, we have different way of wearing the dress, different way of eating, different way of cooking, different way of building the house. The material you need to build a house in Tamil Nadu, the material you need to build a house in Karnataka will be completely different. It will not even be available in other states. Each 100 kilometer, we were so rich and unique. Vedic civilization gave birth to so much of creativity. All the temples of Vedic civilization, is example of our art, culture, and unique architecture. Most important thing you should know, that all these miraculous achievements were possible only because in the Vedic civilization they were able to bring peace in every individual at the level of self. The conscious wealth Vedic civilization has created, Vedic civilization has been and still is a civilization that gifted the world the science of enlightenment. Hundreds and thousands of enlightened mystics and masters walked on this land and spread the science of enlightenment to the entire universe. Krishna, Buddha, Mahavira, Chaitanya, Ramakrishna, Yogananda, Ramana Maharshi, list goes on. Vedic civilization is still the only civilization in the world where continuous unbroken lineage of enlightened masters are still alive. Vedic civilization has been the richest civilization in the world. In our consciousness, she has been the reservoir of consciousness. With maximum number of our citizens flowering into the ultimate space of enlightenment, conscious fulfillment. It's very unfortunate, in the past few centuries, India, which has been embodiment of Vedic civilization, has been subjected to hundreds of invasions from across the globe. Not just politically, socially, culturally. Lots of other nations attracted to her. Peace and prosperity have again and again invaded her. The biggest loss happened to Vedic civilization is slowly we started losing the science of making peace with yourself. We started losing the capacity to maintain consciousness. Please understand, civilization has had, more than anything else, Vedic civilization had conscious richness which was lost by these invasions, and these invasions have destroyed the unbroken lineage of enlightened education and planted useless system of education which will create only bookish knowledge. Now it is time not only people of India, people from around the world realize the importance of Vedic civilization. It is time we all stand and bring peace at four levels: level of self, family, community and society, and bring the Vedic civilization back to life. Bring the Vedic civilization back to living and flourishing civilization. I wanted to bring few statistics to all of your notice. If we don't bring peaceful Vedic civilization back to humanity, make it as living civilization again, we are going to destroy ourselves by the violence. Please understand, violence causes more than 1.6 million deaths worldwide every year. 16 lakh people die every year all over the world due to violence. More than 90% of this occur in low and middle income countries. Violence is one of the leading causes of death in all parts of the world. For youth between the age of 15 to 44, please understand, all over the world, violence is the largest killer. We are talking so much about other diseases like HIV, cancer, H1N1, so many other diseases, but we are forgetting violence is the biggest conscious sickness which humanity is suffering, which is the largest killer, which is number one killer. CDC conducts research on violence, its causes and effective prevention strategies. Studies have shown there are personal, peer, family and social factors that may increase or reduce the chances that a person will become victim or perpetrator of violence. Please understand, it means it is your family and society, the peer pressure, that decides you are going to become perpetrator of violence or victim of violence. Even this statement shows like either you are going to be perpetrator or victim. I don't want to agree to that. You don't need to be perpetrator and you will not be a victim. You can always safeguard yourself. Each year, millions of people lose their lives to violence. September 2011, World Health Organization says millions of people die due to violence. In the recorded history of humanity, since 3600 BC, actually since 3600 BC only, we have a recorded history of humanity. In the recorded history of humanity, 14,500 major wars have killed close to 4 billion people. Please understand, in the recorded history of human civilization, 3600 year 600 BC means 5600 years of recorded history. 14,500 major wars, killing 4 billion people, two-thirds of the current world population. It seems human beings have not done anything other than wars. Only what they were doing is, when they don't feel hungry, when they feel they have a house, they have all the basic needs, come on, take the weapon and go for war. United States is the world's biggest arms exporter, supplies around 40% of the developing world's arms. The US military budget is as large as the next top 10 spending countries combined. Please understand, next to US, top 10 countries combined is US military budget. And Global Terrorism Database, GTD, is an open source database including information on terrorist events around the world from 1970 through 2010, shows, unlike many other event databases, the GTD includes systematic data on domestic as well as transnational and international terrorist incidents that have occurred during this period, includes 98,000 cases. Please understand. Many countries spend over 3% of their GDP just to protect themselves. More than half of the Cambodian national budget, 50%, is spent on defense and security. Statistics on the violence is really shakes us. I'll give you some of the statistics on recent violent attack happened on the Twin Tower. I don't want to get into the detail of who did it, all that. But just on that, because of the Twin Tower attack, what all happened? It resulted in 2,996 people's death. 90% of the workers and visitors who died in the towers had been at or above the points of impact. The North Tower, 1,355 people at or above the point of impact were trapped and died of smoke inhalation, fell or jumped from the tower to escape the smoke and flames, or were killed in the building's eventual collapse. The attacks had a significant economic impact on United States and world markets. The US stocks lost $1.4 trillion in valuation for that week in New York City, about 430,000 jobs, means 430,000 job months, and $2.8 billion in wages were lost in the 3 months after the attacks. September 11 attacks also led indirectly to the US wars on Afghan and Iraq, as well as additional homeland security spending totaling at least $5 trillion. Please understand, $5 trillion, God. It's time humanity joins together as one race, stands up against the violence and terrorism. This can happen only when each individual takes responsibility for bringing peace within himself. My mission, my avataric mission, is to transform an individual so that he radiates peace at the level of self, family, humanity, community and society. It can be done only by meditation and spirituality. Please understand, I have achieved the peace only by meditation, and I have also proven this scientifically through research. When somebody meditates, how he experiences peace inside? Once somebody is initiated into meditation, how he achieves the ultimate restful awareness within, but also complete brain coherence, which resulted in being acutely active externally. Please understand, when somebody's brain is in highest coherence, he is also in peace, and he creates peace on others, on the humanity, on the family, on the society. Now I will give you a scientific demonstration how, if somebody meditates, his system itself experiences peace, and his brain radiates the ultimate coherence, which makes naturally others also experience peace. You can see this demonstration. Now here is one of my ashramites sitting normally. You can see how his brain is functioning. You can see in the monitor, his brain is already hooked with QEEG. How his brain waves are. When he is sitting normally, you can see. Now he is entering into the unclutched space, the space of peace and Kundalini energy. You can see how drastically his brain waves change. You can see very clearly within seconds how the brain waves change. And it moves to the highest coherence. I have done these researches many times. Usually we have some doctors to interpret. I can give you the spiritual conclusions and understanding. When your Kundalini is awakened, when you fall into meditation, when you experience peace and restful awareness inside, your brain goes to highest coherence, influences others also to experience the same peace. I have also recently inaugurated the website minuteforpeace.org. You can log into that website and get more details, like if you meditate 1 minute, you save your country 20 cents from crime costs, and you bring down the crime. Now I'll initiate all of you into a small, very simple, easy meditation technique after answering your questions. First I'll answer your questions, then I'll initiate all of you into a very simple meditation technique for peace, a spiritual process for peace. Now I'll answer your questions.
The first question is from Aarti Desai, Rajkot, India, who's a respected Swamiji. I'm the only meditator in my family. How does my meditating help the family?
She asks Swamiji, I am the only meditator in my family. How does my meditating help the family? Please understand, when you are meditating, naturally your contribution for the family's collective confusion is reduced. Even if one person reduces his confusion contribution, not only your confusion contribution is reduced, others also get inspired. When others are inspired, the peace of the family goes up, the peace level of the family goes up, and the experience of the peace becomes intense. So even if one person is meditating, when your brain goes to the highest coherence, automatically others are influenced, impressed, inspired to meditate and experience peace. Next.
The next question is from Fernandez from LA, USA. Suzette Fernandez, who's asking, Dear Swamiji, when people are not peaceful, even with themselves or their families, how can we interest them in world peace?
You are asking, Dear Swamiji, when people are not peaceful even with themselves or their families, how can we interest them in world peace? Suzette, that is what I am saying. First bring peace to the individuals. You bring peace to you. Whoever you meet, try to bring peace to them. Only when they experience peace in themselves, and naturally they will feel like giving the peace to their families, that is the only way they can share the peace with others. So, if somebody is not able to bring peace within themselves, you can never inspire them to make peace with others. Next.
The next question is from Amrita Ghosh, Kolkata, India, who is asking, Dear Swamiji, I am a child psychologist by profession. It is alarming to notice the rising crime rate among children and teenagers. Since we cannot interest this group in meditation, what is the best way to handle this issue? Dr. Amrita Ghosh, Kolkata, India.
Your concept that you cannot make them interest in meditation is wrong. You can see in my organization, children or teenagers are the most powerful and interesting meditators in our organization. Amrita Ghosh, your idea that you cannot make them interest in meditation is wrong. Bring little interest and spiritual ideas in children and teenagers. That is possible. That's the only way to handle this issue. Next.
The next question is from Prajwal Singh from Noida, India. Namaste, Swamiji. Thank you for taking my question. I have seen that a competitive society itself fosters a subtle kind of violence in corporates, which is accepted by everyone as part of the game. Is there any way that individuals and groups can be inspired to excel without the violence of competition? Prajwal Singh, Noida, India.
Prajwal Singh, capitalism is based on violence. It is nothing but depriving others. Understand? Creativity is totally different. Trying to accumulate by depriving others is totally different. What you are talking, that competitive society and the subtle kind of violence it fosters in corporate companies, which is accepted by everyone as the part of the game, is nothing but encouraging violence. I think it is time every individual should understand creativity-based wealth creativity based richness should be accepted, never violence based. Violence based should never be accepted. It's a big task, but it has to be done. It has to be done. We have to clean up the corporate community and encourage them to stop encouraging this subtle violence. Next.
The next question is from Tricia from USA, who's asking, Swamiji, the statistics you shared are so shocking. Can our individual or small group efforts have any significant impact on huge forces like the governments of countries?
Tricia, understand, the statistics I shared is so shocking, true, but the individual small group efforts can have significant impact on forces like governments of countries, because even if few minds, few brains vibrate in the highest coherence, that creates a huge wave of peace, and it can really impact governments of countries and the decision makers of society. Policy makers and culture makers both can be influenced to bring peace even by a small group of individuals. It is possible, and I have done it, and I have proved it. It is possible. Start. Next.
With so much terrorism, is a peaceful world an achievable goal in the near future?
Avinash Parthasarathy, you are asking a question. With so much terrorism, is a peaceful world an achievable goal in the near future? Avinash, it has to be achieved. We have no other go. Peace is no more a luxury. It's a survival need. It's a survival need. Nothing can be done. We have to do it. Next.
The next question is from Rita Antani from Texas, USA, who's asking, dear Swamiji, thank you for sharing so many precious insights with us. Can you tell me which is the best way to spread global peace in 2012, through love or through meditation?
Rita, first, meditation. Bring love and peace inside you. Only then you can share it with others. Without meditation, whatever you share will be pseudo love. You will share only to the selective people. First, bring meditation. Let your being become intense and matured. Only then your love will be matured love. Otherwise, it will be like 12-year-old girl's puppy love. So don't be caught in puppy love. Let your love be matured, having and sharing peace with the world. Your love should work in that line. Now, I'll give you a meditation which will make you matured and make your brain vibrate in the highest coherence, so that you can radiate peace within and to the whole world. This kriya, the process for meditation which you are going to do, is 2012 transformation kriya. It will bring peace in you and make your brain vibrate in highest coherence and bring peace to the whole world. I bless you all who are sitting with us around the world at this moment. 1,618 places through Nityananda TV and 40 places in two-way video conferencing having Nayana Diksha. In 368 cities in 45 countries around the world. I request all of you to visit the website Minute for Peace and now you can enter 100 minutes because you all sat now 100 minutes meditating and sharing the peace with the world. You all attended the satsang and did the kriya for 100 minutes. I bless you all to achieve, experience, live, express, share, radiate and explode in eternal bliss. Nityananda. Thank you.
Paramahamsa Nityananda, a rare living incarnation, is named among the world's 100 most spiritually influential personalities today. Paramahamsa Nityananda has been placed alongside Dalai Lama, Nelson Mandela, Oprah Winfrey, Paulo Coelho and others by Mind, Body, Spirit, the world's top esoteric magazine from Watkins, London's oldest and largest bookstore. A yogi by birth, he has been expressing his power of enlightenment since birth. He has authored more than 500 books in Tamil and English. Translations of these books are available in 26 languages, in Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, Hindi, Sanskrit, Gujarati, Oriya, Bengali, Marathi, French, Malay, Polish, Portuguese, Italian, German, Danish, Spanish, Russian and Chinese. He is also an exemplary speaker with over 10,000 hours of profound life solutions through his discourses. Social services such as Annadan, free medical care, free educational services with ashrams, schools, temples, hospitals established in more than 140 places around the world, offering exceptional services. A powerful spiritual healer who has healed millions of people of diseases from migraine to cancer. A Kriya Yogi who has formulated Kriyas for physical health and mental well-being, benefiting thousands. A living master who offers practical solutions for our everyday problems. He is the founder and spiritual head of Nityananda Dhyanapitam, a spiritual powerhouse who has revived the sacred Vedic tradition by establishing Vedic temples in places like Los Angeles, San Jose, Seattle, Toronto, Ohio, Oklahoma, Phoenix, St. Louis, Malaysia, Brazil, Paris, Guadeloupe, Dallas, New York, New Jersey, Atlanta, Calgary, Vancouver, Singapore and places in India like Bengaluru, Hyderabad, Tiruvannamalai. A spiritual guru for 10 million followers, an incarnation who transmits the highest spiritual energy through initiation, a contemporary yogi who has revived the Vedic science of yoga worldwide through thousands of yoga centers, an adept in Ashtamahasiddhis, mystical yogic powers, who has effortlessly awakened the kundalini of thousands and graced them with spiritual powers, a dynamic young guru who is an inspiration for thousands of youngsters, India's most watched spiritual guru online, a beacon of spiritual light who has triumphed over the forces of religious terrorism and political persecution. Paramahamsa Nityananda is an eternal Kalpataru, blessing the world with the boons of material abundance and spiritual enlightenment.
Vande Papa Vinashaktam Nityanandaya Swagatam Nityamuktam Nirvikalpam Dhyana Loka Pradipakam Vande Shantamayam Bandham Nityanandaya Swagatam.
let you all achieve, experience, live, express, radiate, share and explore in eternal bliss. Nityananda.
Nityananda Dhyana Peetham, Nityananda Nagar, off Mysore Road, Bidadi, Bangalore, 562-109. Contact 0974-22-033-11. www.nityananda.org. www.youtube.com/lifebliss foundation.